Hello and welcome to the Regular Features Podcast, the podcast that is the same every single week. And like every single week, I'm joined by my best bosom pal, my tit friend, my booby buddy,
chesty confidant,
Steve Hogarty. Mr. Steve Hogarty, what is your feature that you have brought to me today?
I've just come back from America, and that's why I got an accent now and a big hat.
Yee-haw.
And I've been eating some hot dogs and some pizzas. I picked up a twang when I was over there.
Yuck. That sounds great to me. And I have made the mistake of changing my radio station from Radio 6 to Radio 2. And it's given me a whole can of content. Elaine Page, this one's for you, baby.
Bring it.
Bring it and bring your best game, Elaine, because you better not fucking miss.
Are you threatening Elaine Page?
I'm just saying if she misses, it will be embarrassing for her. She's well known for good shot.
Features. The regular features. Spooky noise in your ears. Features. A regular feature. Ghosts and wolves with teeth coming into your bed.
And now it's time for Steve's regular feature.
Yee.
Things what I saw when I went to Big America.
I didn't know you'd been to the Big America.
I did. I went to San Francisco on an aeroplane and I saw some things over there, let me tell you. As is tradition for regular features, if I go to America, I got to come back and say, I look all the things I saw in America this time.
Did you go to the Science Museum where they've got a plasma ball?
I didn't go to the... Did they got a plasma ball there?
I think it's one of the most basic things a science museum can have, isn't it?
That's wild.
I mean, one of those balls where you touch it and it the sparks reach out for your fingers. It's not genuinely full of sun plasma.
Oh, I've got some things. I'm going to list them to you now. I'm going to describe what they were.
Okie dokie.
I saw in America.
I was going to say, one. I'm all ears, but I said I'm all ears while I was talking over you. I'm so dull.
God gave you two of these and one of these.
And I thank God every day.
These are all real things that happened to me. I got to go in a Waymo. Do you know what a Waymo is?
Is that a Johnny cab?
It's a Johnny cab. Well, there's one crucial difference.
There's nothing.
It's a special kind of a car that is operated by a ghost. Like out of the film Ghost.
Oh, can you feel the ghost? Can you talk to the ghost?
You can talk to the ghost. You can see the ghost moving the steering wheel around. Except unlike the film Ghost, instead of annoying Demi Moore near some pottery, it drops you off 250 meters from the seafood restaurant for some reason. Now, I don't know if there's a scene in Ghost where Patrick Swayze makes Demi Moore walk for 5 minutes for some vegan tacos, but if there is, heck... That's very impressive, Waymo. Now,
okay, carry on.
Go ahead.
I do have questions, but I don't want to. I feel like it's things that I should know.
Mm-hmm.
Being 10 years out of a career, a tech adjacent career, I feel stupid for not knowing. Is Waymo controlled by a man wearing an Apple Vision Pro 500 miles away?
No, it's a fully autonomous driverless vehicle that's controlled by a robot brain.
Oh, cool.
On device.
When you said ghost, it made me think it was actually...
Being remote controlled.
Not an person. Yeah. And I'm obviously not believing ghosts, Steve. Yeah. But no, okay, carry on then. I'm now back on board.
It was really impressive, genuinely. By the end of the taxi ride, it was boring not having someone in the driver's seat. And also, you're not allowed to sit in the driver's seat.
There should be a mop that you can comb. Just a mop on a stick that you can play with its hair. And say, where are we going?
Many people criticize Waymo for perpetuating car-centric infrastructure while simultaneously taking jobs away from low-wage drivers. But of the three taxi journeys I took in San Francisco, it was the only one where somebody didn't complain that there were too many Indian people around. So it swings and roundabouts for Waymo, I guess.
Oh, God. Oh, what, in San Francisco?
Yeah.
I thought they'd solved all that over there. I thought...
Oh. Number two, wanked into a hotel face cloth.
Not while I'm drinking, Steve.
You're telling me they give you two face cloths and they don't expect you to use one of them for a posh wank? Why the extra face cloth? What am I, Zaphod Beeblebrox? What am I, a do-duo? What am I, Skeletor's bumbling recruit, too bad, out of He-Man and the Masters of the Universe? What am I, either the cat or the dog from the 90s Nickelodeon cartoon Cat Dog? Get out of here. No, I'm Two-Face from the Batman cartoons, who, despite his name, only has one face. And yes, I'll be using that extra hotel face cloth to dump my jam, ma'am. And I thought of another one, by the way. Krang.
What am I, the guy out of Total Recall with a baby coming out of his tummy?
Yeah, or the woman out of Total Recall with three dirty boobs.
Yes, one towel should see to a face and a boob, and the other yes. towel can deal with the other two boob.
There are lots of things with more things than they should have in that film. I never thought of that.
So can I just ask, did you wank without, sorry, vulgar, did you pull your pud? Did you pull your pud without recourse to the hand, the face towel, or did you use it as a little gut shroud to make it look like you were throttling a ghost?
I'm not going to answer that question. The people who paid for my hotel room might be listening. Number three. This, again, real thing that happened. I think it could rival the bird story.
Go on.
So strap yourself in. Number three, facilitated a damn cuckoo crime, I think.
Cuckoos are fucking big on crime.
I heard this trill sort of a cheapy squeak coming from behind me during lunch. Turning around, I saw the most delightful sight, a tiny bird in search of dropped table crumbs. I watched as the tiny bird would find a few precious morsels, then bounce back to the source of the noise, a much larger baby bird who would shake his wings and shriek impatiently to be fed. The bigger bird had downy feathers and an immature attitude, so I suspected he was just a fat boy version of the tiny bird and chucked a load of quinoa on them. Well, this drove the tiny bird absolutely mental, and she spent ages eating and then gobbing up my lunch into her large son's insatiable screaming mouth. Later that evening, I used the Circle to Search feature on the new Pixel 9 Pro XL to research what genre of bird I had just seen, only to discover something horrifying. That big baby bird was most likely a yellow-billed cuckoo, or Coccyx americanus, as it would be called in the freeze frame at the start of a Roadrunner cartoon. You've heard of Big Bird, right? Well, get ready for Bad Bird. The cuckoo is a species infamous for laying its eggs at other birds' nests when they're not looking, then getting born out of its own egg, then chucking all the non-cuckoo eggs out of the nest. Imagine being one of those unborn chicks, Log. You'd be all like, I can't wait to be born and find out what flying is. Then, and then nothing. Once a cuckoo is king of the nest, he demands constant feeding to supply his large cuckoo body and his dishonest cuckoo brain. And because birds are fucking morons who leave their nests unattended for however long it takes for a cuckoo to come along and lay an egg in it, they actually think these little pricks are their chicks, even though they look nothing like them. They think this cuckoo is the sole surviving chick of some kind of horrible egg genocide that probably happened while they were looking directly at the cuckoo doing it. Far from feeding them quinoa, I should have done what the World Wildlife Federation website told me to. If you see a cuckoo chick taking advantage of a normal bird, you should stomp it to death under your shoe.
While it's still in the nest, just wrecking the nest.
Kicking the entire nest off the branch.
And then just going home incredibly pleased with yourself for delivering justice.
When they're coming up with names for birds, and they got to that one, and they were like, oh, cuckoo. Yeah, because that's the sound that makes cuckoo, cuckoo. And someone was like, oh, is there anything else interesting about that bird? No, I guess it goes cuckoo a lot. What about the bit where, and I looked this up, they're called brood parasites.
Oh, that's cooler.
Call it the brood parasite.
I want to be a brood parasite. How would I go about that? I just have to go into someone's house and just get the baby out of the cup and cram myself into it and then shout, I'm fucking starving when they got home.
That would do it, yeah. Then you'd be a brood parasite.
Just pointing into my mouth like the happy eater sign. Going, in here, lads!
I went on the Wikipedia for brood parasitism. If you go there, they have an example of a nest with 6 eggs in it. One of them is a cuckoo egg. And it's so fucking obvious which one it is.
Aren't they really sort of like, I mean, beauty being in the eye of the beholder, but aren't they fucking obviously stupid? Or just ugly as well. Like big crooked evil wings and that.
They look like an evil egg. It looks nothing like the other ones. The caption says, Eastern Phoebe nest with one brown-headed cowbird egg, brackets at bottom left.
That's...
In case you're as dumb as a fucking bird.
Hang on, that's a Phoebe nest, and you said Cox's Americana. Are cuckoos the cast of Friends? Something to ponder.
Something to ponder. I was trying to think of a Joey bird.
I'm sad that I'm happy. I'm small, but I'm doing fine. I'm lost, but I'm hopeful, yeah. I'm green, but I'm see-through. I'm wet, but I'm somehow dry. I shake when I wobble, baby. And what it all comes down to is that all a jelly boy can do is jiggle and spin. I got no skin or muscle, and my bones are made out of gelatin.
Good list.
Three's a list. That's okay.
Oh my god, it felt so long because it was so good, and so you padded them all out so much.
It's like, 1 minute, my list isn't long enough because it's only got 3 things in it. Now you're saying it felt really long.
I'm just saying that you'll never please me. If you think you're your own worst critic, you're wrong, because I hate everything you do. Speaking of hating everything you do, it's time for my regular feature. Now, every now and then, Steve, you and I both listen to Radio 6, and we both know that they are capable of playing some horrible, unlistenable shit, such as, say, John Coltrane's soprano saxophone hellscape version of the Mary Poppins song My Favorite Things. Have you heard that? Did you hear that yesterday?
No, I haven't. I've not heard this.
I was trying to fall asleep on the sofa and it gave me waking nightmares, half asleep nightmares. I mean, I will say that that song, My Favorite Things by John Coltrane, everyone on the comments on the YouTube version of it, because I went to listen to it again to prove to myself that I wasn't just making it up and it is horrible, they say it's a masterful performance, and they say that John Coltrane had both genius and the discipline to craft that talent into unparalleled skill. I would counter, no, he didn't. It was shit. When a song like that usually comes on, I do one of two things. Option one is to stare in horrified paralysis into the gaps between the molecules in the air until the song ends and my bones begin to loosen. And option two is to switch to BBC Radio 2. Now this is a dangerous gambit, because sometimes when you turn to Radio 2, you forget to turn back. And sometimes, on a Sunday, when you're expecting to put up with Guy Garvey's awful Guy Garvey show until Iggy Pop turns up to boot him out of the fucking studio, you find yourself listening to show tunes with Elaine Page. Now, I am a wet-blooded gay man. I don't mind a show tune or two. So I will put up with this, assuming she's standing in for Craig Charles or something. But what I didn't know is that Elaine Page plays long adverts from her listeners who call in to plug their musical productions. And that is when I heard this beautiful woman.
Elaine, you scream!
Is that real?
That's a woman who phoned into the show, and I strongly feel she's escaped from the feature-verse.
Yes, one feature in particular.
Mwah, mwah. It's Kristen. Kristen Chang here. And I'm in a new comedy musical at the Edinburgh Fringe from the same society that brought you Tony Award-winning Six the Musical to the stage. No pressure.
I kind of like her.
There is something about her that really resonates with me.
I just, I spent a while trying to go, no pressure. I want to be her. I can never be that. I mean, I did have to look up Six the Musical, and it is a historical musical about the wives of Henry VIII.
Oh.
Have you heard, do you know about it?
My Google Home started malfunctioning, and having successfully played BBC Radio 6 music every morning for a year, suddenly started playing Six the Musical on Spotify.
Oh. And
listing all of the dead wives of Henry VIII.
Fair play. It's a good idea, great idea. It's like not, as we were talking about earlier, it's not everyone pretending to be trains, cats, or chess pieces, but it'll do for a bit.
It's called Control Alt Deceit, made up of an eclectic mix of Cambridge students studying everything from computer science to Aluga Arabia.
Cooling off a bit with the whole Cambridge thing. And I did look up Aluga Arabia as an area of study, and I couldn't find anything. So I can only assume she's being Islamophobic, which is not cool.
I thought it was a type of ketchup.
Yeah, that's like arugula? What? I thought you said that when you saw some tits you liked.
Control Alt Deceit is written by PhD law student Ariella Gordon and is set to a funk pop score with a saucy jazz number sung by yours truly.
Yours truly. I'm going to always never like that.
It's grape-salicious coded.
It really is. And while I do love Kristen Chang and her voice, I cannot accept this character that she's doing now as a sexual creature. If she's doing a saucy jazz number, that's like walking on a hyacinth bouquet with on all fours with her knickers down.
It is all performed by a phenomenon, all female cast.
Is that grammar? Is a phenomenon, all female cast? Is that grammar? Mm-hmm. I guess at Cambridge, you can just say that and Stephen Fry will say, well, that's correct usage, actually, because that's DSI.
We follow trusting but tech challenged Aunt June, desperate to connect with her niece, Andy. Oof, talk about teen angst.
What you just described, Kristen, was not teenage angst, it was aunt angst. We have no information about Andy the niece. Did PH student Ariella Gordon clear this phone call to Elaine Page? Because you are fucking it, Kristen.
When Andy suggests June make some online friends, poor woman stumbles upon the dark web and connects with some ne'er-do-wells. Anywho.
Back on board. That was a solid anywho.
Mm-hmm. That was a great anywho.
Elaine, you siren, we adore you and your show. We're at the Space UK at Nidri Street, Venue 9, Fine Like Wine. Please pop by and see us if you're in Edinburgh this month. Whoops, that'll be my cookies. Thank you, and ciao for now.
Ciao for now, is it?
Come on. She's a reader.
Yeah, she has to be. But yeah, love her. From now on, I am going to carry a little bell around with me so I can get out of any conversation by laughing, saying, anywho, then dinging my little bell and saying, whoops, that'll be my cookies.
That is so twee to have an oven that goes ding when it's done.
Yeah.
Because you think it was a microwave. Should go, ooh, that's my reheated tikka masala.
Yes. I mean,
gotta go. Ciao.
Ciao for now. And she is starring in a show about the dark web. So you can't pretend to me that she's using that oven.
Mm.
But anyway, we've established on this podcast that my boyfriend...
Could have been an app on her phone. Tells her when her oven's done.
Oh, yes, a timer on her iPhone 15 Max Pro. Now, we've established on the podcast that my boyfriend Stuart is the king of getting his messages read out on Radio 6. It is show canon that every time he messages Radio 6 to say he's bopping around the kitchen with a vegan Lord sausage bap in his mouth, they'll read it out. Maybe Radio 2 is more my bag. Maybe I can get them to read one of these. I have not read through these. Let's see how they go. Elaine! Elaine, it's Juno Belafonte calling from the telephone alcove in the corollary parlor adjoining the entrance foyer of the Belafonte Manor.
I don't have long because my three pilfering nephews are tottering around on stilts and trying to steal the diamond pendants from our lowest hanging chandelier. I've asked the butler to push them over, but I think he's washed his hands of the whole sordid affair. Anywho! I've booked out the Albert Hall for 3 weeks so I can learn to play the piano in a creative environment. And once I've learned chopsticks, I'm going to be launching my new hit Tony Award-wanting musical, Chopsticks. I will be playing a poverty-stricken chopstick seller on the mean streets of Shanghai. Do you want a chopstick, sir? I'll say to passers-by, pulling down my scruffy little cap and hiding my face so that no one can see that I am, in fact, a beautiful princess who tires of all her ugly little nephews behaving atrociously in the palace and will marry the first man who pops a wonton into her mouth and says, plenty more where that came from, love. The breakout hit single is where I fantasize about getting frisky with a massive wonton. I call it Wantonly Wanting Wonton Wontons. And after that, Nick Offerman's character from Parks and Rec will bring on his only child, Donald, to perform the extended death scene from Lord Byron's poem about the Spanish libertine. I call it Ron Swanson's one son, Don Swanson's long, long swanson from Don Juan. And it's a real showstopper.
Oh, end everything now. That's very good.
Anywho, Elaine, you're a national treasure, and I can hope you can make it down to my opening night where I'll be... Whoops! That'll be my wontons! Bye for now, you gay for pay hack! I'm so sorry, I don't know where that came from, Elaine. Please don't let me implying that you les up for cash stop you playing this call. We all love you around here, even if you do give off that hot whore honk. Ciao! And that's why I never get read out, because I always blow it at the last minute, which is where I think why I blew that there. But finishing it like that led me into my next attempt. Lane, you gas-guzzling hag lady whom I listen to every week. It's Carol here. You know which one. And I've just got my richest fuck buddy to crowdfund a brand new one-woman musical by me. The same Carol who bought you the interactive scratch-and-sniff stink-stravaganza that I call the disgraceful nostril. A show that the Doncaster Echo described as remorselessly pungent, and the Derby Mercury declined to review after their journalist fatally compromised his ethics in my dressing room and cunt. Ooh, anywho! My new show is called That's Simply Not Cricket, and it's about the tennis ball that I've had in my guts since I tried to sunbleach my quim on a whim in the crowd of the Wimbledon Centre Court in 2021. Latest champion Ashley Barty's eyes popped out like gumballs when she saw my recursive spiraling cooch. Wrongly perceiving it to be a doom portal, she sent volley after volley of 120 miles per hour tennis balls fannyward, plugging my Fangelina Jolie with an audible pop. Since then, it's been spinning in my guts like a goddamn Beyblade. Anywho, I'll be singing a saucy little ska punk ditty and inviting members of the audience to pat my clit with a squash racket in the hope that the science of reflexology will cause the ball to spasm out of my mini ha-ha at the same speed it went in. Will it be love all? Or will the stage get covered in deuce? That's for me to know and you to shut up! Elaine, you long dog's dick of a woman. I love your show like I love chewing the skin off my hands and lips. The opening night is at Space UK on Nedgy Street, venue 6, hot like piss. Whoops, that'll be my asshole. Thanks, babes, and ciao for now.
Oh, my God.
I'm sweating, Steve. It's that, a warm
I'm sweating. That one could get read out.
One last one for you, Steve, and it's a character that I know you miss. Elaine.
This guy.
I love your show more than I love sucking off spiders. And if there's any spiders listening, that's only because I haven't managed to suck off a spider yet. I'm sure when it happens, that will be my favourite thing. I'm just putting the finishing touches on a romantic musical for boy spiders or girl spiders who don't mind spraying my face with web from a respectful distance. I am very open-minded, and after 2 years of Spider Dick Desert,
I'll tell you what I get. Since I said that first paragraph, I've Googled whether spiders have penises, and much to my embarrassment, I discovered that they do not. Instead, they have copulatory organs known as palpal bulbs. Perhaps this is why my attempts thus far to convince spiders to put their penises into my mouth have met with a suspicious leg-dipping motion that I understood to be a quadruple shrug. So, I am now armed with new knowledge that spiders don't have a tiny human penis, but have a palpal organ next to a genital bulb situated on the last segment of the pedipalps. Knowing, as I do now, that a spider has two dicks, one either side of its own mouth, that look like little arms wearing boxing gloves, I am thrilled anew at the prospect of getting battered silly by a spider's skillful punches. You know that thing in a cartoon where the boxer moves his fists slowly and the punch bag suspended from the ceiling is just a battered blur bouncing again and again off the ceiling? I've never been excited like I am right now, but I'm also, truth told, less hopeful than ever that it might happen. Because if my arms tapered off to two juicy palpal bulbs, I'd never leave the house. Anywho, this musical is for spiders only. And I know for a fact that spiders love your show, Elaine. I've got a radio in my attic for the spiders. And the scuttling in the rafters in the 10 minutes leading up to your show is deafening. However, if you are coming to the show, not you, Elaine, the spiders, I must insist on only one spider per chair in the auditorium, please, as per fire regulations. Whoops! That'll be my delivery of a Region 2 copy of Kiss of the Spider Woman on DVD. I hope it's what I think it is, and not a Brazilian prison drama about gay humans. Ciao for now!
I love the... And I know you would have thought about this when you wrote it. Quadruple shrug. Some people, they would have gone octuple shrug.
Yeah.
But a normal shrug, you use both shoulders. And we don't call it a double shrug because there's two.
Yeah. What's the wink version of a shrug? That's the cold shoulder.
For the reader's benefit, Log just did the wink version of a shrug.
You've got to feel it before you can comment on it. I read a fair bit about spiders' genitals today, Steve, and I found the most pleasing and the least pleasing sentence of the day.
Okay.
The most pleasing is, the cymbium is the modified tarsus of the palp.
And the grubus is the heaped thalbo of the gronk.
And the least pleasing part of the Wikipedia page of spider dicks is the subtegulum is the main sclerite.
Oh.
Yeah. As in like, oh.
The main sclerite.
Yeah. Way to get me excited and then throw cold water on me, Wikipedia.
It implies there are supplemental sclerites.
Yeah, there's more bits. There's quite a few bits to a spider's palpal.
When I'm drawing them, it's just circle for body and then just all the legs coming out.
Yeah.
You're telling me there's...
If you're drawing a plan view, that's fine. Because, oh no, actually, you can see their dicks. If you're looking straight at a spider, it's got its dicks out and they're pointing at you.
Mm.
Rude.
It is rude. And they're on the palps, the little hands they have in front of their mouth now.
I don't think either of us know what the word palp means, so we should slightly be slow to use it. In case a spiderologist is listening.
I think I inferred through your feature what a palp is.
Yeah, but you know those things that come out by the mouth, like that? And you think they're antennae. They're not. They're his dicks. Or like, until you think they're sort of feeling around. Like,
I thought they use that to shovel food into their mouths.
Wouldn't you just love to shovel food into your mouth with your dick?
Oh, yeah. If they were located by my ears.
I may have misread the page. If I've misread the page, I apologize to everyone. But as far as I'm concerned, if I was a spider, I would just put two dicks in my mouth every morning and chew myself silly.
If you know anything about spiders, don't write in. And now it's time, Steve's regular feature, You Are Sleep Child. Can you creep into grandmother's chambers and put her to sleep with your sweet little boy cousins?
I've been sleep child before.
If this sounds familiar to you, it's because I've done a sleep child feature previously. But don't worry, this one's worse.
Get strong Krangus vibes from sleep child.
What do you get when you fall in love. A sweet boy, little boy who gives you kisses. That's what you get for you and your missus. I just came back from the United States, and with that comes jet lag. Look, it's very jet lagged. I'm very, very sleepy. I'm a sleepy boy right now. I'm a sleep deprived, sleep needing lad. Ooh, that was the chair.
I didn't hear anything, but I'll assume it was a massive farting sound.
Yes. So I'll write this sleepy feature. You, you are sleep child, the sweet baby boy child with them sugar plump lips and a red rosy round face. It is your solemn duty to smack those pink boy wets right on grandma's pillowy forehead. Send that grand old duchess up the wooden hill to the University of Bedford, Massachusetts.
I'd forgotten how much I hated sleep child.
Without those princely little peppermint kisses, grandma's gonna be up all night playing connections on her Samsung Galaxy Tab. And be so cranky tired in the morning, she won't be able to tell her Naga Manchetti from her John Paul Getty. She'll be roaming all around Los Angeles' iconic Getty Center, saying, "So you're telling me that snippy bird off BBC Breakfast built all this? Get the fuck!" And when you say no, Grandma, the Getty Center was designed by architect Richard Meyer. She'll say, "Dick Meyer, like quagmire, like a big stinking bog of cocks you can sink down into. Where does Nonna sign up? Sign up Nonna for the Dick Meyer." Then you'll say, "Grandma, keep your voice down. You're making a scene near a Rembrandt." And she'll lean in real close and say, "You look here, sleep child. I'm never gonna sleep again. And there's nothing you or those shiny orange slug lips of yours can do about it." Do you, A, concede defeat at the Getty Museum? Or B, plant your pink puccarinos right on Grandma's unwitting forehead, even though we're still on a tangent about the kind of thing that might happen if you ever failed to send her to sleep? Grandma is at her most unguarded when she's in imagined and hypothetical situations like these.
It's a good job we've read her character sheet and know all this information. Or it's just long years of living with and kissing her, I guess. I'm not willing to go. I want to get my lips wetty right by the Getty and slap them on her, please.
Kapow! You punch that grey lady's ticket with your adolescent squidge. What happens next is a bit like the part in Inception, where they're all flying back up through the layers of reality. You're no longer in the Getty Center, but back at the foot of Grandma's bed at home at night, where the powerful force of having been smooched by Sleep Child in a potential future reality has sent that pretty little lady off sailing to the Juicy Snooze Parade before anything didn't even not happen to her. Such is the terrible trade of Sleep Child. In the morning, Grandma awakes refreshed as though nothing has gone on. She looks at her connections.
"Ah, I just figured out the final clue. It's Rembrandt."
The group was words beginning with sleep-related things. Rembrandt. R-E-M. Mm. That makes sense now.
I hate those ones.
For the record, the other three clues were alarming, Snorlax, and dream car, as in, "I've just won my dream car."
On the Price is Right.
That's it. Nice. Yeah. I can go to bed now.
Yeah, that one felt quite jet laggy in terms of I just gave me immense vibes, but no real pictures.
Well, yeah, much like a good sleep, you wake up and the dreams fall out of your head and become vaguer the more you pass. I'm sleepy.
When I wake up in the morning and try to do my puzzles, if I'm lying in bed just working up and
the puzzles are ruined by just a phrase that repeats again and again in my head. Ron Swanson's one son, Don Swanson, was one of those. But I thought about it and added Long Long Swan Song from Don Juan. That was me, not my brain, shitting.
That was me, not my brain. I came up with that one.
Fuck that guy.
Pay some coins for some features, and you get a B name. And you get a B name. Oh. Toss some coins for some features, and you get a B name.
Well, that's it for this week's episode of the Regular Features Podcast. If you like the podcast, you can go to patreon.com/regularfeatures and help us out by donating an amount of your choosing per episode. And if you give us £2 or more an episode, we will take your human name, scrunch it up in a ball, chuck it in the trash, like in one of those montages of them working all night to come up with an idea. You know those?
I do think we should chuck it in the trash, look back at them looking at it in the trash, and then decide to shred it in case they try to get it out of the trash.
Well, you know what would make them never want to look upon their old human name again? A bee name.
A bee name.
A fresh bee name from the hive. Log, can you please give bee names to the following new patrons? A bee name, please, for Annie.
Annie, you are the modified tarsus of the palp. The bee version. Did bees have palps? I'm just going to ask Google if bees have palps. Do bees have palps? Clickety clack. It suggested, do bees have palps UK? Honeybees have labial palps. Oh boy.
Hold on, Log. Do people have palps?
Do people palps? I'm just going to Google people palps and see if I can find them on PayPal. It's generating an AI overview. No, it's just telling me about heart palpitations. Like, who on earth in a medical environment says to your grandmother, she's having palps again? She's having big palps. She's all over the place.
I'm sorry, she's palping pretty hard right now.
She's got big palps for Nana. I think, should we change that to labial palps?
No, not for Annie.
Okay, no, actually, yes. Annie, your name remains Modified Tarsus of the Palp.
A bee name, please, for Tyson Lee.
Tie a yellow ribbon round a big fat bee.
That's good. And it would cover up one of the black stripes, giving them a big, long yellow bit? Or would it go over one of the yellow bits and leave the stripy decoration uninterrupted?
Or if you're going into a naughty club where you have to be naked, just shove the ribbon down one stripe. Hey ho, you just look normal.
Ooh, like the divers in the Olympics when the lower third covers their little pants and it looks like they're naked.
Yeah, baby. Oh yeah, that's so good.
And if you'd like your own bee name, patreon.com/regularfeatures. That's the URL. That's how you tell us that you love us.
Yeah.
Money.
If you come to my pub and say, I'm a reader, you get some love. But if you come and say, I'm a bee, I will clamp everything I have around you, drag you to the floor, and start devouring you with my
before
pincers.
You can say the modified tarsus of pal. Yes. We'll be back next week with another episode of the podcast.
You can't stop us. We're already doing it. Steve?
It's happening.
See you in the next episode. Half an hour. I can't wait.
Love you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Regular features. Regular features. Regular features.